This morning we're going to be talking about avoiding the mousetrap. Amen. Would you please stand with me? We're going to read. Our passage this morning comes from the book of Psalms, chapter 77, verses 7 through 20. Psalm 77, 7 through 20 says this: "Will the Lord cast off forever? And will he be favorable no more? Has his mercy ceased forever? Has his promise failed forevermore? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in anger shut up his tender mercies? Selah. And I said, this is my anguish, but I will remember the years of your right hand of the Most High. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. I will also meditate on all your works." I'm getting Holy Ghost goosebumps just reading this passage. "And talk of your deeds. Your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? You are the God who does wonders. You have declared your strength among the peoples. You have with your arm redeemed your people, the sons of Jacob and Joseph, Selah. The waters saw you, O God, the waters saw you. They were afraid. The depths also trembled. The clouds poured out water. The skies sent out a sound. Your arrows also flashed about. The voice of your thunder was in the whirlwind. The lightnings lit up the world. The earth trembled and shook. Your way was in the sea, your path in the great waters, and your footsteps were not known. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron." Let's pray. Lord God, we uplift this, continue to uplift this service to you, and I thank you for your presence in this place. May our eyes and ears be open to receive from you. May our heart be ready to receive what you have prepared ahead of time for your servants this morning. We love you, Lord, and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. You can go ahead and have a seat this morning. You may even want to smile at somebody as you do so. How many here have ever played Mousetrap? A number of us have played Mousetrap. It's been a while since I've played as well. I remember playing with my best friend Roy down in his basement up in Ohio. We played Mousetrap. It was a fun game. Originally titled Mousetrap Game, it's a board game first published by Ideal in 1963 for 2 to 4 players. Over the course of the game, players at first cooperate to build a working Rube Goldberg-like mousetrap. If you don't know what Rube Goldberg is, I'm sure every one of us have seen one of his contraptions in cartoons. Think Tom and Jerry, etc., where they set up this elaborate trap to catch the mouse. If you've seen the new Tom and Jerry movie. Okay. Well, if you haven't, I'm just going to tell you, there's one Rube Goldberg mousetrap in there. It's pretty epic. You can see it in that movie. Or if you choose not to, that's fine, too. No judgment here. So it's a Rube Goldberg-like mousetrap. And once the mousetrap has been built, players turn against each other, attempting to trap opponents' as mouse-shaped game pieces. It's a neat game. Well, this message this morning is a small reminder of how big God is. And how to avoid mousetraps in our lives. We want to avoid the mousetrap of thinking that God can't, because that is one of the traps that the devil uses in order to keep us living in defeat. Our focus will be on verse 12. "I will also meditate on your works and talk of your deeds." It's a good thing to talk about the deeds of the Lord. It's a faith builder, as a matter of fact. Today we'll meditate on his work and talk about his deeds. There will be challenges, trials, and temptations in life, but we have a way of escape. Today we're going to talk about 4 traps and how to avoid becoming a victim. But before we do, I want to show a video. I've showed this video before. It was years ago, but I want to show it again. It's a commercial, and don't worry, no mice were harmed in the filming of this commercial. But if we could, let's go ahead and roll that.
Such a feeling's coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream. I'm on the top of the world.
This is the end. Beautiful friend, this is the end, my only friend, the end of our dear love.
I'm going to tell you something. That's some strong cheese right there. So what is your biggest problem or fear right now? A bill that needs to be paid and an ailment that needs to be healed? An offense that's given you grief? A coworker that's a thorn in your side? A major decision that has to be made? Do you see it? We're going to look at how big God is today and how to avoid traps that the enemy sets for us. The traps of not enough, in other words, thinking that God is limited, or the trap of not possible, thinking that God is too small, or the trap of not forgivable, it's the trap of offense, or the trap of not remembering, thinking too much on the problem and forgetting what God has already done. So let's move into the first one this morning, the trap of not enough. Psalm 77, 7 and 8. Will the Lord cast off forever, and will he be favorable no more? Has his mercy ceased forever? Has his promise failed forevermore? Is there enough of God's favor, or has God run out? I'm going to tell you this morning that God has plenty. His resources are limitless. God is more than enough for every situation in our lives. Satan tries to get us to think that God is limited in his resources, or that God wants to limit your resources. And this started in the Garden of Eden. The devil asked Eve, he said, "Yea, hath God said, you cannot eat from any of the trees in the garden?" He was placing false limits on what God had given in the garden with the goal of getting Eve to sin. Same lie, different day. My daughter sent me a picture of a woman and a man, and it said, the reason when men ask a woman where they want to go eat, and they say it doesn't matter to them, is because the first time they chose, it doomed humanity to destruction. I'm talking about the Garden of Eden. So we have the same lie, different day. Lie number one, there's not enough healing for everyone, just special ones. Lie number two, there's not enough blessings for everyone, just the chosen ones. And lie number three, there's not enough anointing for every believer, just the leaders. When you play a board game and you're not sure the rules, you consult the rule book, do you not? So let's consult the rule book concerning the three lies we just looked at. Lie number one, there's not enough healing for everyone, just the special ones. Goodness. John 19, 30. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Jesus finished the redemptive work at the cross. Hello. Jesus finished his redemptive work at the cross. Isaiah 53, 5, you are familiar with this passage. We say it a lot here, and the reason being is because we believe it here at this church. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are what? Healed. You know that scripture. We will keep saying that scripture until Jesus comes back. Amen? The reason being is because we believe that is a promise to them that believe. By his stripes, we are healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's been plenty of stories of people getting healed over the years. I can remember being in Africa when we were there. We broke up into different teams. I think there were three different teams. And the amazing things that were happening when we were laying hands on the sick. One of the testimonies that came back, Terry Durio, I'll never forget him telling me his testimony. And he was telling about a guy who had a deaf ear, and there was stuff just seeping out of the ear because, I mean, they were out in the bush and there was nothing they could do for it. They laid hands on this guy and that seeping stopped immediately and his ear opened up. Why? Because it's the power of Jesus Christ, the power of the anointing flowing through them. It wasn't because of that one student or Terry. It was because of Jesus Christ and his redemptive work on the cross. Hallelujah. When Christ went to the cross, he did it for all mankind. His healing is not limited to certain people. It's for all that will receive it by faith. We know Romans 10, 17. We've said it here many times before. Now faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And listen, it's not just when we've got the written word and we also have the spoken word. There are times when the Lord tells us to do something and we do it by faith. That's right. Why? Because we hear his voice. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And he tells us to do something. We step out in faith to accomplish those things which he calls us to do. Does this make sense this morning? I'm getting excited about this because I know God is calling us as a church to a higher level. Amen. Hallelujah. He is calling us forth to minister to our community. And we can do that not through defeat, but rather we're going to walk in power that God has given us to go do the things he's called us to do. We don't have to walk in fear, doubt, and unbelief, but rather we walk in faith. We walk in power. We walk in His anointing. Listen, we are the vessels, okay? You say, well, I'm not good enough. You don't, listen, He uses crackpots just like me all day long. Hello? We are earthen vessels, and it's His anointing that takes care of the issues. Amen? I've likened it to like a straw. You could take a straw. I've got one down here. I'm going to use it. You could take a straw and run liquids through it. Is it the power of the straw that quenches my thirst? No, it's the liquid inside the glass, right? We are like that straw. Okay, sometimes we noisy straws. Well, we're like that straw, and the Lord is wanting to pour His anointing through us. He's wanting to use us for His glory. That'll preach right there. One of the steps that keeps us from faith is to ignore hearing the Word of God. I'm going to tell you this, and I mentioned this before. If the only time you're hearing the Word is on Sunday mornings, then your faith is starving. If the only time you read the Word is on Sunday mornings, then your spirit is starving. If you want to have faith to be healed, then saturate yourself with the Word of God. Shut out everything that is not of faith. Shut off the things that promote fear and doubt. Do you think Hollywood has any plans of good intentions for you? It does not. I'm about to meddle. I'm going to do it. When we purposely sit down to watch a horror movie, you are opening up your spirit to fear, doubt, and unbelief. You are not building your faith. You are shredding your spirit. Oh, God, help us. When we sit down to watch violence and entertainment of that, you're not building your faith. You're building anger. You're building fear, doubt, and unbelief. And you are shredding your spirit. And when I say shredding your spirit, I mean literally shredding your spirit to where healing needs to take place. You say, well, Pastor Jason, I can handle it. I've seen that stuff before. What you are entering into is a seared conscience. I remember the first time I watched a particular movie, it was very violent. I almost threw up. Now it would be considered very low-key compared to what's out today. What I didn't realize what was happening on the inside of me was my spirit was being shredded. There's something that happens to our souls and our spirits when we watch these things. The Lord Himself says that He detests violence and them that take pleasure in those that do so. It's something we need to be very careful about. And I know I'm meddling. We need to shut up the devil by quoting the Word. If you want to have faith to be healed, then saturate yourself with the Word of God. Open up the Word of God and let it permeate your being. Carve out time every day to fellowship with Jesus, a healer, and let Him anoint you with the healing power and fire. We serve an unlimited anointer. His knowledge is unknowable. His reserves of anointing are immeasurable. His mercies are new every day. Hallelujah. His sacrifices for all. His promises for sure. And His delight is in His children. That's good news for us this morning. The Lord is waiting on them that will spend time with Him. And those that purposely grow close to Him will benefit the most. Peter, James, and John had the benefit. They saw Jesus talking with Moses and Elijah. Isn't that something? The others didn't get to see that, but Peter, James, and John did. Why? Because they had a close relationship with the Lord. They witnessed Jesus' transformation. These things happened because they chose to be a close bond with Jesus, and they were constantly at the feet of Jesus. And you don't have to be a Peter, James, or John to benefit from healing. Jesus came to set the captive free. Hallelujah. We see this in the Word. He came to heal the sick. But when you start growing close to the anointed one and His anointing, you will desire to see more, to learn more, and to love more. There's more than enough healing for everyone. Line number two, there's not enough blessings for everyone, just the chosen ones. Let's look and see at some of the possessions of the Lord. Psalm chapter 50, verses 10 and 11 tells us this. Psalm 50, 10 and 11 tells us this. Are you ready? For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle upon 1,000 hills. I know all the fowls of the mountain, and the wild beasts of the field are mine. The Lord owns it all. It's His. It makes sense because He's the one that made it all to start with. Amen? We know from Genesis that God created everything. He created the beasts of the field, the fish of the sea. He created man. He created woman. He made it all. Therefore, guess who it belongs to? It's His. It's His creation. Hallelujah. Proverbs 10, 21 through 24 tells us this. The lips of the righteous feed many, but fools die for lack of wisdom. The blessing of the Lord makes one rich, and He adds no sorrow with it. I'm glad to hear that scripture. Amen. To do evil is like sport to a fool, but a man of understanding has wisdom. The fear of the wicked will come upon him, and the desire of the righteous will be granted. What's your desire this morning? Are you living out His word? Hallelujah. There's no lack of blessings here. Those that serve the Lord are blessed. You don't have to be an apostle, prophet, teacher, pastor, or evangelist to receive the blessings of the Lord. Hallelujah. You have to be obedient. Deuteronomy 11, 26 through 28. I love this passage. It says, "Behold, I set before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you will obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you today, and the curse, if you do not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn aside from the way which I command you today to go after other gods, which you have not known." You see this? Obedience to the Lord opens the blessings of the Lord upon your life. And Satan will try his best to sell you the lie that only certain people can receive blessings. And the truth is that the Lord blesses the obedient ones. He does. Lie number three, there's not enough anointing for every believer, just the leaders. Listen, this is a matter of knowing who you are in Christ. Revelation chapter 1, verses 4 through 6. "John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you, and peace from him which is, and which was, and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen." How many know that as believers you are made kings and priests? That's who you are. Both get anointed. Hallelujah. If the Lord didn't have enough anointing, he would have put limits on it. But he's got plenty of anointing. Instead, he's got so much anointing that he made all believers kings and priests. I'm in the presence of kings and priests this morning. And so we have such a title, should we not act like it? A king has authority. You with me so far? We have authority over the enemy. Luke 10, 19, make it yours. Are you ready? Jesus said, "Behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." This is a promise we can take right into the heart of battle, folks. This is a promise we can take from this place when we go minister to the lost. He has given us authority over the enemy and to trample on scorpions and snakes and serpents and all those things that we don't like. And nothing shall by any means hurt us. So when the wicked rise up against us, we know whom we stand. We know in whom we believe. And so long as we are doing the will of the Father, we have nothing to worry about, even if it costs us our life. This world isn't our home, folks. There's something we get so earthly minded, we end up not doing anything for the kingdom. That's a scary thing to get into. But rather, we should be heavenly minded so that we are earthly good. Amen? All right. Well, let's move on. A priest has duties to perform for the Lord. And we have duties to perform for the Lord. Colossians 3:23, "And whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men." You may be working for a hard person right now. Do your work as unto the Lord, like the Lord's going to be examining it. Like you're blessing the Lord. Amen? A king is anointed to exercise his authority. And we are anointed to exercise our authority. Matthew 28, 18 through 20. "And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Amen. That means so be it. And a priest is anointed to fulfill his office, and we are anointed to fulfill our office, whatever it is that God has called us to do. You see, the Father is not short on anointing. We are anointed because his vats are bottomless. Amen. We avoid the trap of not enough by knowing that our God is not limited, but is limitless. He has more than enough to meet our needs. His mercies are new every day, and I'm thankful for that. The trap of not possible. Sometimes life seems to send things our way that seem impossible. And you may be thinking about a problem that you have, a bill that seems impossible to pay, a sickness that seems impossible to beat, a situation that seems impossible to change, a habit that seems impossible to break. But can I tell you that our God is a God of impossibles? That he can make all things possible to him that believeth. Hallelujah. Hebrews 11, 1 through 3 gives us insight on how to make, he makes the impossible happen. And this is it. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it, the elders obtained a good report. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. You see, Jesus gives us the ability to make the impossible possible. And he gave us a solution to the impossible. Mark 11, 22 through 24. This passage comes right after the disciples are walking by and they see a fig tree that Jesus had cursed the day before. I mean, the fig tree had leaves on it. It was good to go, but it didn't have any fruit. And Jesus cursed that tree. The next day, as the disciples are walking by, the disciples are baffled and dumbfounded. And they're like, look, Jesus, the tree you cursed is dead. It's withered. And Jesus says this. He says, and Jesus answered, saith unto them, have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore, I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. That's what Jesus said. This isn't the words of Pastor Jason. This is the words of Pastor Jesus, of King Jesus, of the priest Jesus. He's the one who set these things in motion. Amen. So what is the mountain that needs cast into the sea in your life? The key is to see it flee, is to speak to it. Jesus spoke to the fig tree and it died. Jesus spoke to the little girl and she came back to life. Jesus spoke to Lazarus and he walked out of the grave. I love the fact that Brother Daniel told us this morning about how Lazarus stunk. I got a question for you. Do you liveth or do you stinketh? And it's a valid question to ask. You see, when Jesus showed up at the tomb of Lazarus, Mary told him, but Lord, by now he's been dead for 4 days, and by now he stinketh. That's the King James Version. I love that version right there. He stinketh. They knew what happened after 4 days. Lazarus began to rot, and he smelled bad. He smelled really worse than a teenager, hadn't had a shower in a week. I mean, he's just bad. And what does Jesus say? Does he worry about the smell? No, rather, he begins to speak life into Lazarus, the man who had been dead for 4 days. And some of us need to speak life into a situation that we've seen dead for so long. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. Oh, by the way, roll the stone away. When they wrapped up the dead, it was difficult for Lazarus to come out, but he managed to get out of there. I'm sure he had supernatural help just getting up. But my understanding is he'd probably be doing this as he's coming out. And what does Jesus tell him? Unwrap him. Because you don't wrap dead things in grave clothes. I mean, live things in grave clothes. The only thing you wrap in grave clothes are things that are dead. Lazarus wasn't dead anymore. Hallelujah. Glory. Proverbs 18:21. You don't believe that this is for us yet? Proverbs 18:21 is a great scripture verse to understand and memorize. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Some of us need to be speaking life into our dead situations. Speak to that mountain and tell it to move. And when Satan tries to push you into the trap of not possible, you fight back with a word by reminding him that with God, all things are possible. All things are possible to him that believeth. Jesus said that to a fellow. His son kept had seizures all of his life. And a lot of times this devil, this seizure would come upon him and cast him into the water to try and drown him, or cast him into the fire to try and burn him. And Jesus, and this guy took his son to the disciples, and the disciples couldn't cast out that devil. And Jesus said, bring him here, you faithless generation. And Jesus cast out that devil from him. When the devils came out of that boy, he fell down to the ground like he was dead. And they're like, oh, you just killed him, Jesus. That kid was probably relieved to have those devils out of him. If there's any devils bothering you in your life, be free in the name of Jesus. Picked the boy up, and the boy was fine from that day forward. No longer tormented by those devils. The disciples asked Jesus, why couldn't we cast them out? Jesus said, this kind only comes out by prayer and fasting. There's something to be said about fasting. I know we don't fast devils out, but at the same time, there's something to be said about fasting in this case. Amen? So along with the trap of not possible is the trap of not forgivable. It's AKA, I call it the trap of offense or offense. The problem with being offended is that it's a slippery slope. It leads to bitterness. Bitterness leads to hatred, and hatred leads to death. You've heard it said that hurt people hurt people. Even so, oftentimes offended people offend people. If Satan can get our eyes off of Christ and onto our offense, then he can render us powerless in our battle against him. Not only that, but Jesus has a lot to say about forgiving people. I want you to notice what's at the end of the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6, 9 through 15. You know, the disciples came to Jesus and said, teach us how to pray. Jesus said, this is how you should pray. In this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. So who are we to pray to? The Father who is in heaven. We don't pray to anybody else. We don't pray to saints or anything else of the sort, because Jesus never told us to do that. That's a man tradition, man-made tradition. We're called to pray to the Father in heaven because Jesus said so. Jesus taught Mary how to pray. We don't pray to Mary because Jesus taught Mary to pray to the Father. Make sense? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And that's where we normally stop, right? I want to read these next two verses to you. Jesus said, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Cool. But then he had to throw in this next verse. Way to go, Jesus. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Ouch. Come on, Jesus. Couldn't we just leave that one off of there? Nope. It's not the only place that Jesus talks about forgiving. Forgiving people is not always easy, but it is possible. And we're commanded to do so. Our first step in getting rid of offense is to make the decision to forgive. Write it down the day that you forgive somebody. And every time the enemy brings that up in your face of what they did to offend you, you can bring up the fact that you've already forgiven them. And eventually, this is a promise, eventually your emotions will catch up with your decision to forgive. It'll happen eventually. It may take time, but it will happen. Jesus set the ultimate example of forgiving people in Romans 5:8. You're familiar with this passage, but I'm going to read it again. But God demonstrates his love toward us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. One of my favorite passages is found in Mark 11:20 through 26. And it has an aha verse at the end. And we just read it earlier. We read this. It said, and Jesus answered, saying to them, have faith in God, for verily I say to you, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be cast into the sea. You remember this? He gets through all of this. It shall, whatever you say, it shall be done. But then he follows it up with these two verses, verses 25 and 26. And when you stand praying, forgive, if you have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. I can live with that. But then he goes on and says this in verse 26. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. All right, Jesus, I'm starting to see a pattern here. Now we need to do what? Forgive. I've mused this passage for years. I've looked over it. And I admit that this chunk of passages is one of my favorites. It's a faith passage. I like faith. God is the God of faith. He's pleased by faith. But also, I see where forgiveness reigns as well. That's part of love. What I found over mulling over this passage is that I have no excuse to harbor offense, bitterness, anger, nor hatred. You see, Jesus took all of my excuses when he nailed my sins to his cross. He took all of my excuses when he said that I'm to follow after him and take up my cross daily like him. And I pray that if you've fallen for the trap of offense this morning, that today would be the day of your freedom. One of the scariest things I have seen is people who have harbored offense so long that they become numb to the nudging of the Holy Spirit to forgive. And maybe we need to ask the Lord to open our eyes, to check us, to correct us if needed. It leads us to our next trap this morning, the trap of not remembering. Satan will try and get you so focused on the problem that you won't remember that there's a cure. Let's remember some of the awesome things God has done that are recorded in the scriptures. Are you ready? When Lot was captured, God sent Abraham a great victory. When Sarah was barren, God sent her a child in her old age. When Israel was captive, God sent Moses to lead them out. When Israel was stuck between the Red Sea and certain death, God caused them to walk through the Red Sea on dry ground. When they were hungry, he fed them with angels' food. When they were thirsty, he gave them water to drink from a rock. From a rock. You can't, I've held rocks in my hands before. I've never been able to squeeze water out of a rock. But the Lord God quenched the thirst of millions through a rock. When they were hot, he shaded them with his glory. When they were cold, he warmed them with his presence. When the lepers sought Jesus, he healed them all. Hallelujah. When the blind man asked, Jesus restored his sight. When the disciples thought they were going to drown, Jesus calmed the raging sea. And when the 5,000 were hungry, Jesus fed them with 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he had leftovers. That's the God we serve. He is the God who provides. He is the one who cares for us. He loves us. And he's made every provision for us to be successful in his will. When man sinned, God sent a Savior. When Christ left, he sent us the promise of the Holy Spirit. And when Pentecost came, believers were empowered. Hallelujah. I'm so glad. I'm so thankful for Pentecost. I'm glad to be Pentecostal. Hallelujah. I'm so thankful for the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm so thankful that Jesus said to the disciples, "You tarry here, you wait here. Until you receive the promise." You see, the Holy Spirit is the promise to them that believe. Not just to the 12 or to the 120 that were in the upper room, but rather to all them that believe. It's not just for special ones. Golly, that kind of thinking right there, bless your heart. Jesus didn't send the Holy Spirit just for special people. He sent it to them that believe. Which technically are special people. What I mean by all that is that the Holy Spirit's there for every believer. God wants you to be empowered not only to witness, but to live as witnesses for him. He wants us, when we're walking through the streets, to be in tune with his Spirit. And as we're walking about, to be sensitive to what the Lord tells us. To be sensitive to what to pray for, what to do, how to live, how to give. Amen? We started this morning with Psalm 77. I want you to listen again to these verses. And I said, "This is my anguish, but I will remember the years of the right hand of the Most High. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. I will also meditate on all your work and talk of your deeds." Did you know that Jesus did so many miracles when he was on this earth? That the word of the Lord tells us that there would not be enough room to write down everything that he did. It'd fill this planet up We got a little glimpse through the Gospels of what Jesus did. We got a snippet. And his Spirit dwells inside of us. Is this making sense? As his Spirit dwells inside of us, that means we're called to go forth and do what Jesus did. Jesus told the disciples to go and make disciples of all men, teaching them everything that I have commanded you to do. And lo, I'm with you, even to the end of the age. We haven't hit that point yet. Listen, when the disciples died, the gifts didn't die out with them. Amen. When the disciples passed away, the miracles didn't cease there. I'm a testimony. I have seen miracle after miracle of God's power flowing through me and in the lives of others. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God has not stopped healing. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God has not stopped baptizing people in the Holy Spirit. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is just as mighty and powerful today as he is written in the Word of God when time began. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that he will continue to work in my life and in yours until the day that the Christ returns and calls us home. Amen? I know this is true. You can't convince me otherwise. I know his presence is real. I know his word is holy. I know that he is just. The question is, will we choose to follow after him? Will we choose to be a vessels for his glory? Will we choose to be the straws? Amen. I choose to be a straw for him, to be a vessel for his glory. How about you? How about you? Your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? I can tell you this, there's nobody like our God. You are the God who does wonders. You have declared your strength among the peoples. We can avoid the trap of not remembering by purposing in our hearts to remember the mighty things God has done. Meditate on his ways. Write down all he has done in your life. And go back to those every once in a while and bless the Lord. Nothing wrong with that. Go back and look at that list. You'd be surprised at how much God has done. And I'm looking forward to the day too when we get into heaven. The Lord says, yeah, you didn't know this was about to heaven, but happen, but I intervened. Hallelujah. I know there's been plenty of times that God has intervened. I know that there have been times where I have been delayed in driving, and that used to really irritate me. I'm getting better, by the way. The Lord has been working on my heart and my driving skills. Hallelujah. But now there have been times where I've been delayed, and as I'm going, I finally get through. I'm frustrated. I'm like, God, I needed to be there at this time. He's like, I did this on purpose. There is a reason why you are late. And if you know me, I hate being late. I would rather be an hour early than 1 minute late. That is my personality. I can't stand to be late. It bothers me beyond belief. That's one of my pet peeves, is being late. So when I get late or get behind and I get frustrated in traffic, and there have been times the Lord said, I did this for your protection. And then it's like, oh, thank you. Amen. I'm meddling. Meditate on what God has done. Would you please stand with me? I would like for the praise team to come. I have a question. I actually have a number of questions this morning as we close. Have you fallen into any of these traps? The trap of not enough, thinking that God is limited, or the trap of not possible, thinking that God is too small, or the trap of not forgivable, harboring offense, or the trap of not remembering, that is, meditating too much on the problem and forgetting what God has already done. So is there an issue at hand? What's the issue at hand? Is there an issue at hand? Will you let God provide and show you that he is the God of impossible? And if you need a miracle this morning, would you please come and we'll pray as a group together. But I want to open up the altar this morning. Just say that if you've fallen into any one of those traps, would you give it over to the Lord and follow after him? I'll pray with you if you want. I'll be here if you want to pray. But this is between you and the Lord. So would you come as the praise team leads us in a song?
Oh, that I may know. Oh, that I may wish. Oh, that I may bow at your feet. All I have to offer, all I have to give, everything.
Let's close together in a word of prayer this morning. Father, we do worship, we praise you and thank you. Lord, we remember the great and mighty things you've done in our lives. Thank you for pulling us out of the pit and setting our feet upon the solid rock of Jesus Christ. Thank you for empowering us to live as witnesses and to witness to those around us. Thank you for your Spirit going forth with us from this place, empowering us to do the things you've called us to do. I thank you that we have ears to hear what you'd have us to do in these last days. We love you, Father, and praise you. We call forth those that are locked in the kingdom of darkness. We call them out of darkness and into the kingdom of light. We call forth those that can't hear to hear now. We call forth those that can't see to see now in Jesus' name. And Lord, may your will be done through this church body as we go from this place. Thank you, Father, and praise you. We look forward to hearing good reports this coming week. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you for coming this morning. You are dismissed. We'll see you in small groups tonight.